Oh, my dear friends, it has been so long, but I am finally back with another project for you. Now, you may remember this little guy from the last project that we did, and if you thought that we were done with Mary Poppins projects, then you were wrong. Now we are onto something a little bit bigger. Her carpet bag. Now, I know what you're thinking. Josh, you already have a carpet bag. Yes, I do. This pile of tapestry, you may assume it's a carpet bag. I made this, I think, in 2016. It's pretty old, but it does have a couple of tricks up its sleeve. Let me just see what I can find in here. We got Mary Poppins books, Mary's lovely hat. It does seem there's like one more thing in here.
I thought I saw it.
Here it is. Oh, it's the Broadway one. Ew. So yes, this bag does work, but it's not the prettiest. So follow me along on this journey as I make an exact replica of Mary Poppins' carpet bag. Yes, there's going to be many parts and a couple of friends along the way. So get ready as we continue our Mary Poppins journey.
I never planned on creating a second carpet bag until I found Bravacali Art on Etsy and let them know how impressed I was with their Poppins umbrella replica. Saith was the one behind them, and we began talking carpet bags as this was his next planned replica. I mentioned I'd love to see a bag made with the same pattern as the original, yet we both knew that this would be extremely difficult to accomplish. I offered my old carpet bag pattern to create his bags, but I'd update it to be a bit more accurate. As we talked more, I became increasingly interested in creating a new bag. I found an Etsy shop that could make a custom carpet, so I toyed around with photoshopping the floral pattern with auction pictures as the original bag. This was a tedious process of not only piecing together sections of flowers, but also re-illustrating the image so it would print correctly onto carpet. You can't print a picture of carpet on carpet. I mean, you can, but it won't look right. As I shared my discoveries with Saith, he also became interested in creating an accurate bag, but keeping the shop bags a different floral tapestry material he had already purchased. After many hours, the floral pattern was coming together, and we had our first look at what the actual area rug that was used to make the 1964 bags may have looked like. A large part of creating the bags was getting the help of manufacturers. We prefer to do things ourselves, but sometimes you don't have the right materials or abilities to do so. I never worked with manufacturers before, but this was something Saith was familiar with. The original carpet bag had a very curved frame that is not produced today, so Saith scoured the internet for a company that can make a correct frame. One said they could, made a sample, and it was not it, so we asked to try again. We also found a manufacturer to print two area rugs for the exact replica bags Saith and I would make. Meanwhile, I began creating a whole new carpet bag pattern in Illustrator. I used scrap muslin to create a test bag to test the shape, a first look at the finished bag's size. It was also during this time I realized the bag's interior is suede, at least basing off the texture and pictures. So little is publicly known about this prop, which led to many guesses. I'm looking at you, Walt Disney Archives. After a trip to Joanne's for suede, Saith informed me that he got a picture of the correct bag frames. We loved them until the manufacturer said she would refuse to make them as they were too difficult. Saith had already paid, they agreed to make them how he originally asked, and we were screwed. The frame of the carpet bag is a key feature that sets it apart from other similar bags, and due to the manufacturer wanting to drop out, it appeared we were going to have a flat frame. It was determined in order to finish the remaining six in the order, an additional mold fee of $150 would have to be paid. At this point, Saith had already put a lot of money into the replicas for a shop and wasn't sure if he could make an additional expense. So I offered to pay half the mold fee so we could create the most accurate bags that have ever been made. It was truly moments like this that made us a team. Saith and I discussed everything together, down to the smallest details, just because we cared so much about this movie and the props that bring its magic to life. After the frames were successfully ordered, we hit another road bump. The leather buckles purchased could not be cut into the shape of the originals as planned. I offered to create the buckles, and I got to work finding accurate ones and looking for leather. We also finalized our floral design and sent it to the manufacturer. A few weeks later, the frames arrived, and Saith sewed his first carpet bag. The custom-made handles also arrived, and we got our first look at what our authentic replications may look like down the line. Saith and I were both shocked to receive a video of our carpet being printed by the manufacturer. We began analyzing the grainy, blurry video right away, trying to get a good glimpse at how the print turned out. We then waited patiently until finally receiving videos of the completed carpet. Our main concerns were print quality and color, but it was extremely difficult to tell by the graininess of the video. As we waited for our carpets to arrive, Saith released his shop bags to the public, a major milestone for our carpet bag journey and a hit among customers. After what seemed like years of shipping, the carpets arrived at Saith's and he sent me all the media he could. The carpet seemed at okay quality, but the largest flaw was the lack of black in the areas that were supposed to be. Nonetheless, we were happy to have the carpet and what it meant for our bags. Saith got right to work on his bag and warned me of the many challenges that were to come with sewing carpet. Even so, I still wasn't prepared for what was ahead. The day finally arrived where I received my carpet bag care package from Saith, including a bag frame, handles, and of course the carpet. I was beyond thrilled to see our culmination of hard work in person, and it was astonishing. For years when I was younger, I would scour the internet for the carpet from the movie, hoping I could find it somewhere. Now, it was in front of me. I couldn't wait to get started, but we were still missing leather for the buckles. On a trip to Joanne's, I spotted sheets of leather and noticed the shocking resemblance to the leather on the originals. I became determined that maybe I could make both the buckles and handles. I talked it over with Saith, and we agreed it would be a safer and more accurate option than trying to match the factory-made handles. I bought the leather and began my research on leather craft. Leathercraft is an intense and multi-step process that I was truly unaware of before this project, mainly because I don't have a large interest in it. After creating a pattern of the handles and buckles, I cut the leather to shape. It took many cuts and a lot of time, but I got there. Once that was complete, I made any necessary holes for rivets or the buckle straps. Even with a heavy-duty machine, sewing the leather handles was the most challenging part. I eventually made it and began burnishing the edges. Following burnishing was a layer of leather balm for a top coat, which is buffed on, and then an edge accent like the originals. Finally, the rivets were set with buckles, and the leather components were complete. Sewing leather was one thing, but sewing carpet was another. After transferring the pattern to the carpet, with the help of a friend, I began carefully cutting the pieces. Saeed informed me that his bag was not closing due to too much material on the frame. Because of this, I adjusted the sides so they tapered toward the top. It was then time to begin sewing. Due to the thickness, the foot pedal would not power the machine most of the time, so I hand cranked the needle through. Slowly but surely, I attached the sides to the main piece.
Here is my current sewing situation. I have this piece down. This is all just kind of wrapped down here, and I'm just chugging my way along.
I then did a stitch around the top to add definition where the frame would go. After a lot of hard work and sweat, the initial bag was sewn. Following this accomplishment, I marked where the handles and buckles would be placed. Carefully, I set each rivet until my bag was adorned with leather components. Since the bag was complete on the outside, I took a picture and sent an email to Tony Walton, the designer of the original prop, along with the costumes of Mary Poppins and many other beloved shows. I didn't expect he would see it, but thought why not after all this work. Sewing the suede interior was the next item on the list, so I pinned the sides together and began sewing. Afterwards, I slipped the interior over the bag, good side out, confusing, I know, so it could be sewn around the top edge. The easiest place seemed to be my bed, so I prepped the bag and prepared for what was next. Finally, the interior was attached, so I stapled the remaining suede to the baseboard. To my absolute shock, I ended up receiving an email back from Tony Walton. I was over the moon about him saying anything to me, but was even more surprised when he shared photos of his original design sketches along with a picture of him and his wife of the time, Julie Andrews, also known as Mary Poppins herself, but to which he called, "What's her name?" I highly recommend watching the Mary Poppins episode of Prop Culture on Disney Plus, not only to learn about the carpet bag, but also to see this darling man talk about his beloved costumes. After an exciting email from Tony Walton, I began the process of hand sewing the bag frame into place, as it would be almost impossible with a sewing machine. I used a glove for extra grip going through the carpet. When it comes to the bag, or any prop, I'm always asked, why do I care? Really, it comes right back to watching the movie when I was 7, amazed at the magic Mary possessed, but at the same time wondering how they did it. Replicating these props brings the film off the screen and into reality, acting as a keeper of memories, nostalgia, and magic. This film not only fired my passion for creating and imagining, but also holds a lasting, powerful innocence that I'm continuously moved by. I'm proud of my efforts and even prouder of the connections I've made along the way.
Well, folks, we did it. This thing is absolutely insane. The amount of work and effort and love that went into this bag is crazy, and it truly feels like I have a piece of movie history right here in my home.
Usually when I make a replica, it doesn't feel completely like the original, but this carpet bag gives me the same vibes as the movie, and it is so rewarding. The carpet has its flaws, but turned out okay, and even though the handles are a little shorter than the originals, I am still proud of my leather work. Overall, I love how this piece came together.
I just want to say a big thank you to Saeed for helping me on this journey. This would not have happened if it wasn't for you. Please go check out his shop, Bravocali Art, for more Mary Poppins inspired items. And I'd also like to say a big thank you to Tony Walton for responding to my questions and designing these amazing pieces of Hollywood history. Well, I have got to go, but I hope you guys enjoyed this series, and I will see you next time. Goodbye. How do I look? Oh, God! How do I look? Cheeky. Mary's lovely hat. Oh, that's sad. Also, this thing is hefty. It's like heavy duty. But I mean, come on. You can't...